Well, hello there again, everyone. Yesterday, I did that short web kind of presentation for the Eastern Ohio Grazing Council for the March meeting, and we talked about spring being upon us. And I went home to feed cows, and of course, our cows are still on heavy use pads. Some of them are still on stockpiled grass. But and as I was feeding cows, I said, you know, I'm moving on to spring here, but I really need to think of a better way for next winter. We've got a heavy use pad, been using heavy use pad for years, but I'm just not happy with the results. So kind of looking at other options and thought, well, this may be a good web presentation to do for everyone else. Maybe everybody else is thinking as we go out of winter and into spring, we need to be keeping our eye on what we're going to do next winter. And I don't want next winter to be like this winter. So I need to keep it in my mind that we need to make a change. So hopefully we're going to talk about some issues and some ways to correct problems we cause in the winter. I thought it would be important to kind of go through the different management strategies we have in the winter and things that I see people using. So first one out of the gate is sacrifice areas. This is kind of what I call the do nothing approach or the do what we've always done approach. We pick an area of the farm. Hopefully we pick an area of the farm. We don't just let them do it all over the farm, but we pick an area of the farm and we haul hay out there to the field, and we create some messes in and out of gates, and the whole field pretty much ends up torn up through the winter time. If you can't tell, it's not my preferred method of winter feeding, especially these last two or three winters where it's been really, really wet. And those fields take a long time to recover, sometimes 2 years to get them back to something, sometimes longer than that. So that's kind of the lower tier option of what to do in the winter. And this is somewhere that I don't want to be. We want to be better than just a plain sacrifice area. But if we have to, it takes a well-drained soil away from a stream, and those areas need to be rotated and annually. The challenge is, of course, dealing with the mud. Animal comfort becomes a problem because those cows get muddy or sheep get muddy. Sheep especially don't like mud. They'll avoid it at all costs, even if that's where the feed is. Soil erosion becomes a problem, and you know, we're all big about solving that problem. Water quality can be an issue, even if the stream is a good enough distance away. And then the area will have to be reseeded. Now, we can look at this as a challenge or a good thing, because we may get some new forages out there. But I'm telling you that sometimes we pound the soil so hard that it takes a year or two to recover. So even if we plant some awesome seed the next spring, we may not get anything to grow. So we'll go on and we'll talk about another management practice. What used to be one of my favorite ways to feed hay has become probably one of my least favorite ways, just because of the winters that we've had the last 3 or 4 years. Unrolling hay is a beautiful way to feed cows or sheep, even if the weather's froze, if it's dry, even if we have a light snow cover, 2 or 3 inches of snow. But after that, if it's really wet and really muddy, we end up unrolling a bale of hay, and by the time you turn around to look at the bale, the cows have already tromped it all into the mud, and you're starting over with another bale. That's what kind of led me to build a heavy use pad, was because I unrolled a bale of hay in March 1 year, and by the time it got to the bottom of the hill, I couldn't see any of the hay anymore because the cows had tromped it all in the mud. But a good way to feed hay, if we can count on frozen weather. The problem is around here, we can't count on frozen weather. I know that this winter we've had 6 frozen days because I was home either hauling hay home from other farms those days or hauling manure to a stockpile area on those days. So with only 6 frozen days out of the year, it made it real hard to pull cows off a heavy use pad and take them out to the field to unroll hay for 1 day and then turn around and head them back to the heavy use pad. A good plan, as long as we have frozen weather, maybe a good plan to work in with some of the other practices we're going to talk about, but can have its challenges because of the weather. Also, it wastes a lot of hay. This is good for lower quality type hay because, as Pete Conklin called it, bed and breakfast hay. That's a good way to put it. They're going to lay on a lot. They're going to waste a lot. If we expect those cows to clean it all up or sheep to clean it all up, our animal performance is going to be really hurt. So just another practice. We're going to go on to the next one. Bale grazing. This one's kind of got some renewed interest, I guess, right now, especially with the regenerative folks. This is a system where we take bales and set them out there in the field on 25-foot centers. We build temporary fence around them, and then we move the temporary fence to allow cows access to them. I guess you could haul hay out there, but you're giving the livestock a new strip of ground every time you move bales. The regenerative folks are using this in dry times and in the right climates to help bring soils back. You know, you're putting a lot of manure down, a lot of waste hay down, and it will really make a field look good. The problem is those are in maybe some more brittle climates, some more drier climates. Here in our wet climate, bale grazing works great there again when it's frozen, when it's dry. It really works awesome when it's snow covered. The last real significant snowfall we had a couple years back, we had a bale grazing field then. Was the best thing we could do in that time period. I like to set out some bales at home and be able to bale graze if the weather gets to that point. If it doesn't, then those bales eventually get pulled in. We use them for something else in the spring, but I do that just in case we have a deep snow. The problem I have with bale grazing is in our wet winters, the areas near the water trough get tramped up tremendously bad. And we can have days where it's really wet and really muddy. I mean, you're basically using a bale ring out there in the field, and we can lose a lot of soil right there around that bale ring. Now, I've done some compaction tests and found that it really didn't do as much damage as we thought it did. But these areas then will have to be reseeded. Some of them will have to be kind of graded and leveled back up before we do seed them back down. A good way to feed hay, it's not something you want to go back and do again the next year. You got to rotate that annually. But if we wanted to cover the whole farm and we don't mind having a little bit of mud and we don't mind them walking back in the mud trails to get back to water, we could use it. But it really, again, not my preferred way to feed hay. Heavy use pads. These can be constructed of concrete or gravel. Concrete, of course, is for someone that's going to clean them really frequently and usually going to be done in conjunction with an animal waste facility. Gravel is something that's going to be cleaned less than three times per season or per winter. Gravel, of course, is a little cheaper. Concrete's a little more expensive. Most of these, I mean, if you work with NRCS, we typically are talking about a heavy use pad. The problem I have with heavy use pads is heavy use pads alone aren't an end-all be-all practice. We've got to have a watering facility with a heavy use pad right there close by or on the pad for sure. Pipelines to get to it, maybe a pumping plant. I'm starting to put mounds around our heavy use pads so that the animals have somewhere to get up off of those pads when they get wet and sloppy. A lot of them really do need an animal waste facility close by, right off the edge, so that we can push the wet, sloppy stuff into an animal waste. A lot of them now are getting roofed too, just to keep out the rainwater. Heavy use pad, I guess, is just not the end all be all that we once thought it was. I think that there's a lot of other practices we need to put in conjunction with a heavy use pad to make it work really well. Do I like heavy use pads? Yes. Do they need other practices? Most certainly. I've yet to see a heavy use pad that didn't have a runoff potential, one that wasn't roofed, let's put it that way. We get a heavy snow melt, and that thing washes off the pad. So it's going to have some runoff issues. We got to worry about storm manure. If we're letting the animals come on off the pad, we're going to have mud at the edges. I really think most heavy use pads require some bedding just to keep them from getting so sloppy. I use a heavy use pad at home, and I'll tell you my number one concern with it is animal comfort. With just a plain heavy use pad, this winter it's gotten way too sloppy, and we weren't wasting near enough hay, and I just think that we have to put some of these other practices with it to really make a heavy use pad go. I think it's going to take a lot of carbonous material, straw, waste hay, sawdust, shavings to help kind of put a diaper on all that manure, soak it up, maybe make something we can compost later. Heavy use pad's a good practice. Again, not what I would consider the best. Dry pack barns are another option for winter feeding. One that we don't talk a lot about, one that we probably don't think about enough with as grazers. But I've been around some really good dry pack barns. I've been around some really expensive dry pack barns. I think this is something that we all deserve to take a look at a little bit more as time goes by. I think that we basically build a barn and then we allow the bedding to build up through the winter. So it does take some bedding. It takes some straw or some wood chips or sawdust or waste hay. We can build a separate bunk feeding area that the cows can eat off of, and that kind of ends up making a separate kind of animal waste for the wetter manure to be stored in, because you don't want to put that in on your bedding area. But in the end, we can kind of pile that manure up inside the barn, allow it to compost, and then get it spread back out. And I think as we go further down the soil health route, we're going to find that this may be preferable to doing a heavy use pad with an animal waste, where we're actually letting that manure compost some before we go ahead and spread it out back on the field. The challenges here are they're expensive. There's just no way to put a roof up without it being expensive. But if we consider all the things that the benefits we might get from it, I'm not sure that we'll find that this is expensive as we thought. I know for beef cows, and it's not a profitable situation a lot of times, but boy, if we could put up a hoop building or a cheap structure and be able to feed cattle in it and have some carbon material to put in as bedding, this is really a good way to have to feed winter feed in our area with the rain and the mud that we get. Probably one of the better ways to feed cattle in the winter time. And finally, to stockpiled grass. I'm not sure that any of you that are still watching, there may not be many of you still watching, thought that this was going to be in my winter feeding slide, but this for me is top dog. This is the number one way to feed anything in the winter time with stockpiled grass. I got on there the most natural method. I don't think we can argue with that. We keep a cow grazing, we keep sheep grazing through the winter time. That is the most natural way. It's the way that nature intended them to be. The manure recycles directly back on the soil, and I probably didn't talk about this enough in these presentations, but part of my concern for winter feeding is that manure on a heavy use pad tend to turn anaerobic, and I'm not, as we go down the soil health road, we're starting to see that maybe some of that anaerobic manure isn't the best thing for our soil health as well. So we can turn that manure right back to the soil surface. Boy, we don't have to worry about water quality concerns because we've got it spread out. It's not blasted all over a field. Stockpiling can be used in conjunction with heavy use pads or mounds to reduce mud. You know, Alan Nason talked for years about a cow only grazes 8 hours of the day. We can let her out there, let her graze for 8 hours and bring her back to a heavy use pad or a mound to spend the other duration of her time, 16 hours of the day, back on that heavy use pad to keep it from tearing up the pastures. I know farmers get concerned about stockpile grass. They say, well, you know, if I turn all 25 cows out there, think of the mess they'll make. Well, I guarantee you, if you turn cows out on really good stockpiled grass, even in the muddiest of days, and you only give them a couple hours and you move them again, give them couple more hours, move them again, give them a couple more hours, you'll be amazed at how much damage they don't do. I have 10% of our herd out on stockpiled grass this year. I just rode over the field last night. I did some frost seeding on it, but I'm amazed at how much it's not tracked up, and the cows have been on it all winter. So it's something to give some serious consideration to. Yes, if we're going to stockpile with the farm that we currently have, we got to reduce animal numbers, but I promise you that the decrease in animal numbers will more than make up for itself in increased profit that we're not spending either making hay or buying hay to be able to bring those cows. Plus the health is going to be amazing. The health difference that they're going to have by being out in the field is going to make a huge difference. So all the slides I put challenges. For me, stockpile forages don't present any challenges. Other than I have to stop grazing them August 1st so that they do stockpile. Outside of that, If I'm feeding hay, that's taking time, and with a tractor. If I'm feeding in a dry pack barn, feeding hay in any way, I got time invested in putting hay out. With stockpile grass, yeah, I got time and going and moving the fence, but it's a whole lot more enjoyable time out there on the four wheeler and walking around with the cows for the 10 or 15 minutes I'm going to be there than it is to slog through the mud. So this is my preferred method, if you were following along, you probably saw that I put these kind of in the order of the way I prefer things to be. But I think we all need to work a little harder at extending our grazing season, grazing cattle or sheep or whatever we happen to be grazing further into the winter to be able to give ourselves a fighting chance of having a better winter next year. All right, that's a wrap for this web presentation. I hope maybe I got some of you to thinking about what we're going to do next winter. Let's not go through the summer. Let's not think about how happy we are at spring without giving a little pause and a little moment of thought to how we're going to make next winter better. What are we going to do to make next winter better? Every winter, it seems like I get to this point and I'm so happy it's spring that I forget about what we did this winter. And this winter, I just want to be able to look back and say, I don't want to do it this way next year. I want to change something. And now's the time. It's April. Before you know it, it'll be August. And that's the time we need to be moving some cows, the time that we need to be building stockpiled grass if we're going to go that route. But I hope that all of you are thinking about how we can make our winter feeding systems better. This, folks, is our number one problem probably in Eastern Ohio. And it's something that we all need to address. We all need to do a better job at. And we here at NRCS Soil and Water, we'd be glad to help you out. We'd be glad to talk over options with you, work on a grazing plan with you that includes your winter feeding strategy. Thank you all very much.